Welcome to Making the Jump. In today's episode, I'm going to provide you with three tips for improving your synchronous online video conferencing classroom experience. So stick around. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Making the Jump, a video series on innovation in digital higher education. I'm your host, Justin Hodson, and in today's episode, we want to talk about how do we improve the synchronous video conferencing classroom experience. I'm broadcasting to you today sort of live, right, from my home office, which is essentially a guest bedroom that's been temporarily converted to deal with the reality that our campus is all online the rest of the semester. And as most of us in higher education have moved to the online experience, we are trying to accommodate different kind of learning strategies, different kind of teaching approaches. And many folks are using Zoom and similar video conferencing tools to hold synchronous class meetings in place of the regular class meeting. But I had a colleague earlier this week who emailed me and said her first meeting with her class wasn't quite as engaging as she had hoped it would be, and asked if I had any tips and suggestions. And so what I want to do in this episode is at least give you the three tips that I gave her, which are the three tips I give everyone as a starting point when you think about moving a regular classroom experience into a virtual video conferencing experience. And those three things are: teach how you teach, include the social five, and provide pre-class prep. Now, when I say teach how you teach, if you sit down at a desk and you talk with students, you have a seminar to kind of discussion, then sit down when you are in the virtual conference. But I teach standing up, and I walk around the classroom, and I find it very awkward and uncomfortable to try and sit down and then have a conversation with students. It just doesn't feel natural to the way that I teach. So when I set up my Zoom conference meeting or whatever the video conferencing tool you're using is, I actually make sure that I'm standing up while I'm talking with students. And there's a certain comfort in that kind of engagement. I mean, there's a lot of different things right now going on between how we move from face-to-face to online. Students are adjusting, instructors are adjusting. And so the more you control or minimize the transition in terms of the disruption, the better you're going to be. And I just find that in particularly with my undergraduate classes, if I stand when I am engaging them, it just seems much more natural to the way that I normally teach. And I think it helps with the conversation and putting me at ease, right? So we're all dealing with a bit of anxiety. And so when we're in the online space, teach how you teach. That's sort of my first and probably the most important thing I can tell you what to do. The second one is provide include the social five, right? I know a lot of folks who class starts at 2 o'clock, they turn on the Zoom space or their Google meeting, whatever, at 2 o'clock, and they just start. And I always say you need to set up your classroom and join it a few minutes ahead of time just to spend some time socializing with students, right? Get to know them, get to chat with them like you would do in a normal class, but check on them, see how they're doing. Now, if you've got 100 students, it might be a little bit different, but there's a certain kind of engagement that happens, a camaraderie as we all chat and commiserate and express the realities that we're going through. And giving just a few minutes before class can really make a huge difference in the kind of in-class engagement as people are a little more comfortable in the space. It's no different than when we give interviews. We spend a few minutes before we actually turn the camera on to interview somebody or turn the recording device on, talking with them, getting people comfortable with sharing and putting them at ease. And then the same principle works here. The third thing that I tell folks is to provide pre-class prep. And I've touched on this a little bit in another video on pre-class videos and post-class videos. But you know, going into a virtual conference, a virtual meeting with students as a classroom experience, everything takes twice as long, right? To have a 10-minute discussion will take you 20 minutes just because of the way you need to pause more frequently, the way you have to wait for the chat space to fill, the way people are awkward in terms of turning on the cameras or mics and talking and that kind of stuff. So the more you can prepare them coming into the space, the more efficient and more effective you can make that Zoom or virtual conference meeting engagement work for you. I use Zoom a lot, as you can tell. So I send them the notes ahead of time, what to expect and how to prepare. So what to expect is sort of laid out what we're going to do in class, but also what I want them to do when they join the meeting, whether I want their camera on or off, whether I want their microphones on or off, how we're going to use the chat space in the location or the slide share, whatever the case may be. And then I also have them, give them guidance on how to prepare for that meeting. So I'm meeting with students on Thursday this week, for example, and I've already given them instructions on the procedure I want them to follow when they log in. And I've also given them really explicit instructions on what I want them to bring to class, like what kind of questions or concerns or things to focus the experience. Because the reality is the online virtual meeting together in place of a class is never actually like a regular class. The online virtual conference is much more like a mix between a classroom lecture discussion experience and office hours, right? And so We want to try and maximize what that experience feels like for students because it's experiential. That's what we're looking for at our core. So when I go through the process of helping students prepare, I think about what do I need to accomplish in this conversation, lecture, engagement, discussion, however you want to frame it, and then how can I also make it appealing to them and give them agency in the space? So I not only talk about what we're going to cover in the class and give them at least a bit of foreshadowing, but then I usually ask them to come with questions or things that they, if they have questions, to bring them prepared to ask me so that we can use that space as a collective discussion on administrative procedures, you know, issues, assignments, points, things that I can cover outside of class. But there's a certain sense of splitting the classroom experience and the virtual space between a discussion, content, lecture, and the nuts and bolts of what we're doing, how we're doing it. And the more I can prepare them for that, I think in the back end, the better. Because again, I approach the online classroom experience, the synchronous classroom element, as a hybrid between a regular classroom engagement and the kind of independent conversations I have in office hours. So I think there's a mix of everyone learning, also with the intimacy of engagement. So the more you can prepare them, the better they're going to be. So those are my three big tips. You know, they're not mind-blowing, but they can really make a huge difference in your overall experience as an online synchronous virtual conferencing teacher. Also, don't be afraid to call students. Call on students to ask them to explain what they've done, have people expand their comments in the chat box. You know, really think about the strategic engagement that you're providing. But really, if you can teach the way you teach, you're going to be more comfortable in the space. If you can include 5 minutes ahead of class, they're going to be more comfortable in the space in terms of the social. And if you can give them a preparational orientation, whether in video or text or whatever, in your LMSs or through email, they're going to know much more directly what to do with the online space engagement and how they're supposed to operate in that space. And that can really streamline everything for what you're doing and make it much more of an effective engagement. So those are my thoughts and comments today. If you like what we're doing, feel free to subscribe to the channel. Otherwise, you know, stay safe out there, wash your hands, and I hope your online experiences are fun and engaging, but also not devoid of innovative approaches and really thinking about the learning experience you're providing beyond just how do I turn my class into an online sort of engagement, right? So really think about learning experiences. Otherwise, check you folks later. We'll catch you on the next episode. I'm hoping to add some more interviews down the line, and we'll see where we go from there.